So when I first got to Eventide, I had to make a TTY decoder, right? Which is this in-band signaling before texting that they used to strap this device on a phone. And if you couldn't hear, you would text over the phone and it would sound like a modem.
Right. What year is this you're talking about?
It's 2008.
Oh, wow.
So basically, I had to make this thing and either it worked or it didn't, right?
Right.
So that was just what I did there is I took apart one of the old detectors that they used to have, and I, you know, researched the circuitry in there and realized it was using what you call a PLL, a phase lock loop. So we were having to write an algorithm in 56K, so I took that phase lock loop and virtualized it and wrote it in code because I figured
gotcha.
If that's the way they were solving it back then, I should probably do it that way now.
Right.
So
And it worked.
And it worked.
Cool.
Yeah. And then I guess the next big thing I did was I helped one of the other senior DSP engineer at the time, Dan Gillespie, do pitch factor, some mod factor work. And then they gave me the lead on space.
Mm-hmm. Oh, cool. Great.
Doing
Yeah, we love space. We're big fans.
I learned a lot. Doing reverb design is a lot. You know, it's not that it works or it doesn't. And I had to learn that it was done when I would play with something I had made. And if about an hour or two went by, and I didn't know an hour or two went by.
You knew it was good.
I knew it was good.
Now, that's cool. We're big fan. I mean, I'm a big fan of the black hole. I mean,
love it.
I mean, there are a lot. Once I started using it, it really was so different and so weird, but yet so cool. And you could put it on a vocal, a snare, this and that. And it was just fun. You know, it was
great.
That kind of thing where, you know, I mean, we're both older guys, but part of what makes it still fun is doing new shit.
Yeah.
Like trying stuff. And it's like, I do the same thing all the time, but the 5% of the time that I try something new and have fun with it makes, you know, makes the day kind of neat, you know, makes it more interesting. Anyway, so black hole, we love.
We love it. How'd you get involved with the H9000?
I was always involved with the H9000 from the moment I signed the contract. I remember riding in the car with Tony when he took me to the airport after the interview at Eventide.
Wait, you've been designing the H9000 for 10 years?
Sure, yes.
Really?
Well, on and off. I mean, somebody's been working on it for about 10 years. I was in the car with him, and he was taking me back to the airport after my interview with Eventide. And I was thinking, well, that didn't go well. I'm not working here.
And were you really thinking that?
Yeah. I mean,
he took you to the airport?
Yeah, he took me back to the airport.
That's so nice.
For future reference, if he takes you somewhere and he says it's the airport and it's somewhere like
the
in the
Pine
Meadowlands,
Barrens.
Exactly. That's who he doesn't hire.
That's it. They never find again.
Right.
Nobody gets hired.
The airport is good.
Nobody hires that guy.
So I made it. Yeah. He said, what do you know about rack processors? I said, I don't know anything about rack processors. And he goes, well, we need to refresh our H8000. We need to make an H9000. And that was probably,
oh, cool.
That was probably 11 years ago.
Wow, okay, I didn't realize you guys were working on it.
And were you unfamiliar with studio hardware?
I would say yes.
Mm-hmm.
I was always just a player, so right. I knew pedals, and I knew, you know, preamps and stuff like that. And I guess we had mixed in college in one of the bands I was in, we mixed our own record on a Digi 002.
Mm-hmm. How much of your programming, or you're working for Eventide, are you informed by being a musician? Do you think that has any bearing?
Yeah, it's pretty much probably the strongest thing I bring, I would imagine.
How so?
I mean, anybody can learn to write code and stuff, but if you don't have a musical sensibility for how something is going to work, even if you're a beginner at it, you know, it's almost impossible to know when to quit and know when to, you know, it's one thing in a school project is to go get, you know, an A+ and get a 4.0. It's another thing to know when to stop something in such a way that you ask someone to give you money for it, and then you make enough money to live, right?
Mm-hmm. Right.
There's like a chasm between those two things.
Right. At the risk of being too gushy,
yeah,
that Eventide thing has been traditionally guys into music,
well,
musicians
designing
shit for making music, right? Because if you think
your brother,
Richard also just, you know, they had the studio upstairs from them on 54th Street.
Right.
So they'd walk the shit up to the studio and just try, you know what I mean? It wasn't like just a bunch of guys in lab coats coding.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it was really, it was guys who listened to FM music all day, like Bob, you know what I mean? It was people who were really immersed in music.
Right.
So that's where he came from.
Right.
More importantly,
right?
Because I was just, you know, working, putting the shit together. But you know, it really is important. I mean, that environment, if you guys could remember my memory of 1978 there in the basement on 54th Street, was Scott Muni on the radio.
Scotto
and Bob Dylan and John Paul, one of the guys who had like a reel-to-reel of one Bob Dylan song over and over again for like 32 minutes. It's the same song because he loved that song. So it was like that kind of, I won't even say excess, you know what I mean? But that kind of quirky.
It was a musical environment.
Yeah, it was totally amazing. Right. So anyway, that's my take about it. So it makes sense that you're now a bass player. And
do you think in your being hired by the person who's not in the room, that you, the fact that you were a bass player influenced him thinking that you should work there?
I don't really know.
Did it even come up?
I would imagine the fact that I was, you know, I toured a little, you know, I mean, I never got past a minivan pulling a trailer, but I did play in a band that booked shows and toured. So I think that definitely influenced it. Right. There's a lot of people they were interviewing and, you know, having some musical experience, especially getting into guitar pedals, which I knew a lot about.
Right. Were you involved in the Rose pedal?
Not really, except to sort of be a cheerleader along the way. I do like the way it sounds. It's got one of those hard to put your finger on it kind of sounds, right?
What do you mean?
It's got soul, right? This is the best quote I could come up with about the Rose, right? And I said, maybe our other delays are like Steely Dan, right? But the Rose is as like James Brown.
Oh, cool. So
it's as perfect as it needs to be, but you can't really explain it. It's got soul.
So it took 10 years of sort of not full-time work on the H9000, but you've been paying attention to it and been part of that project for as long as you've been at Eventide.
Yeah, it's not like a 10-year linear progression. It's sort of...
Did it take so long?
It's a wandering path. It's a combination of people being in charge, coming and leaving, over-spec designs, redoing those designs, realizing you have way more complication than you thought when you started making a UI.
So, but it took all this time. It's out on the market now. People are loving it. Was it worth it spending all that time?
From my perspective as a signal processing engineer, it got us, or it's getting, I should say, it's getting us off of that 56,000 chip I'm talking about. On that chip, I was having to write code in assembly, and it's very time consuming, and so the majority of my work for the H9000 was taking our existing code and porting it to C++, which is a more modern language, which makes us cross-platform, which means, you know, we can run on an ARM chip, which the H9000 has, but that same code can run for the native plugins. So from my perspective, it was totally worth it because now I can write more stuff faster.
For the 9000.
For anything. Our code is for the pedals too. Yeah, our code is cross-platform.
Oh, great.
So in the 10 and a half years you've been at Eventide, your knowledge of all this stuff has
expanded.
Exponentially expanded.
Yeah, I mean you read a bunch of stuff that, you know, you read a bunch of code. Some of it, I've seen some of Tony's really old code in 2016. A lot of the core processing algorithms were written by a kid Bogdanowicz, the guy at Sound Toys, the H3000 team, right, wrote a lot of this code. So there weren't a lot of comments about why the things were the way they were. So a lot of times I felt like a DSP sort of, I don't want to say forensics because the stuff was alive, like a detective, right?
Yeah. Makes sense.
So yeah, I had to put the story back together about what this stuff was doing and why it sounded the way it sounded. So yeah, I probably have a pretty deep knowledge of Eventide sound.
Are you constantly thinking of new things to present to the staff? Or like, as you're working, I know you worked on Physion.
Yes.
That was a big one for you, right?
Yes.
And how did that idea come up? Or can you tell us a little bit about that plugin?
That idea has been around in like the literature for a while. This morphological component analysis is the technical term. Right. When you can separate a sound on morphologies, so... One morphology would be what we would determine transients as, like, you know, sharp things, sharp attacks, or sharp edges. This exists in like vision or image processing, right? You can separate a picture based on the sharpness of a group of pixels or how smooth they transition. So you could do the same thing with audio.
So there's a visual transient, so to speak.
So the idea that we could do this in near real time and do it in a way that's you know, creative and gives, you know, engineers, musicians a new tool.
Sure.
Mostly probably just came out of discussions. We have a consultant who's a PhD researcher. And when we hired him, we were just discussing things we could do realistically. Right? What, Eric, we got, we have you as like sort of a brain trust now. Now, you know, how are you going to make money for us?
Right. Well, me and Stuart spent a lot of time in the '90s talking about how do we make this snare drum sound like a banjo? What was going on there? No, but I do like the first time we remember the first time we used the plugin.
Yeah.
It was actually really fun. Right,
it was crazy.
And it did actually make a snare drum sound like a banjo, which I loved. Yeah,
but you can pull apart anything. Any sound could be pulled apart. Every sound has a transient, pretty much.
Yeah, and it's. I mean, it's
mostly any musical sound.
Well, sure, yeah, because most musical sounds tend to have an onset and a resonance.
Right.
So anything that's sort of voice is a little bit different, but it still kind of works on voice, right? There is. You could consider the glottal pulse as a sort of an onset or something.
Well, once you have written, once a plugin comes out or a piece of hardware comes out, do you stop thinking about it or do you keep wanting to modify it or?
Yeah, you don't want to stop, but it's hard to stop because it can always be better. I still want to improve Physion. It doesn't work well enough for me. I know where it breaks.
Can we talk about why?
Why?
Why doesn't it work well enough for you?
Because it's not physically true or possible. So, but it's kind of a magic trick, right? There's some edge cases. I'll give you one good edge case. So if you're playing around in Ableton, right, and you make a synth that has a high chirp rate, boom, boom, boom,
right,
that chirp rate's too fast, and that even though that we perceive
it won't
that
catch
as, it, that'll all end up in the transient channel, right?
Okay, gotcha.
So anyway, so pro tip if you want to bring up the plug.
No chirping from me.
or you got to chirp like. Right. Like that. That's not gotta be the chirp. Is that wrong? Why are you laughing?
No, it's good.
That's actually right. It's accurate. Fucker.
Doesn't sound like a chirp though.
I came in with a lot of sass of a today. Chirp, I'm full of
on
sass.
Fire,
today.
Man.
So when you're done at work at 6, 7 o'clock, you go home, do you like turn it off or you don't? Are you constant? Do you watch basketball? Do you listen to music? Do you go see concerts? Do you, you know what I mean? You go bowling? Is it all, or you just like really kind of sit, like, is this always really in your head?
I have a 5-year-old and a 3-year-old.
Oh boy.
Boys or girls?
5-year-old girl, 3-year-old boy.
Good luck.
So wow. Does that answer that question?
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. So you're married with kids and all that. You're a dad. Oh, great.
Yeah.
Okay. So then you have a life. You're not just a bot. And like, you're just not like programmed all the time to think about this stuff.
No, I you know, I have to, I try to get the kids involved in music.
Do you still play?
Yeah, I play. I was playing before kids. I was playing in bands in New York, but now I only play at church at this, the gospel service.
Great. All right. Well, that's fantastic. I think that's
awesome. Awesome, Russ.
Yeah.
Thank you so much for coming.
Thank you, guys.
Tony
wants me to go code.
Every second of nonsense is more time he's going to have to spend.
Yeah, these guys are way more expensive than we are. That's for sure.